Okay, thank you all for coming along. If you can, come a bit closer to the front, because part of this session, it's quite different from the kind of sessions I'd normally present at this conference. So often I'm next door and things like the SysAdmin mini-conf doing something quite technical. This is a lot more community orientated. And one of my goals is for a large part of this to be participatory. I want to learn from you, the audience. I want to set a certain framework, but a large part of this is about discussing where we go next. Okay? So, almost open, just close the door behind you. So I've been with Red Hat about 5.5 years now, but I've been dealing in Linux and open source in excess of 20 years. And one of the things that comes up around this is, what does open mean to you? What does open mean to you, Mr. Customer? What does open mean to you, my business partner, to you as a developer, to people within government who are now starting to understand the importance of open data and open APIs? What is the definition of open to them? So that's the first thing I just want to plant with you, is think about what open means to you, and what does open mean in the context of the people that you deal with regularly? We're at this conference, the first thing often springs to mind is Linux and open source. They're very, very closely coupled. Linux could be about things like, you know, the open source initiative, a group that helps define a lot of how we deal with the source that is open. But often we may turn to open in the terms of open standards. And this isn't all open standards, this is just open standards, say, in the context of mobile. This is just a few of the open standards that exist in common mobile technologies today, and that is even all of them. This is just a small snapshot. We look at this in the context of our environment. You're largely talking about things like open data. Many of you know my wife, Cherie. She's been helping run GovHack in New Zealand for the last few years. Open data is a very hot term today. Opening government. Governments are realizing the importance of the data that we as members of society have already paid for through our taxes, making those things available. Open government. Open hardware. A conversation this year is about the future of open source, or the future of open, because it's more than source. It's now about open design patterns for things like hardware. So there's a lot more to open than the source. And a familiar thing is this conflict, in a way, between the terms open and free. People often ask me, what do I do for my job? I convince people to pay money for free software. That's a large part of my role. I convince customers, I convince businesses, I convince government organizations to consume open source rather than the traditional proprietary products that they're used to consuming. And hopefully, along the way, Red Hat gets paid a few dollars, I get paid, it's all good, I can supplement my wine collection, life's good. But there's this conflict about free. What does free mean in the context of open? And it doesn't help that these two organizations regularly have a conflict of interest, disagreements around the terms open versus free. So again, when you're engaging with a government department, with an organization around data and APIs, there may be this conflict. The moment you think you mention open, they may think you mean free. You know, we've regularly used the terms libre and gratis rather than open and free to try and deflect confusion about terms in the English language. Just because it's libre doesn't imply that it's gratis. You have the freedom to go and consume this data in interesting ways, but you don't necessarily have the freedom to consume it without paying for it. Certain government APIs may be chargeable. Certain access may need certain controls around it. What we then need are open standards around APIs, around accessibility to data, accessibility to services. The other thing to realize is all too often, where the service is gratis, you are the product. We all use these things. Snapchat, Facebook, Twitter, and Google. Do any of you here pay for those services? Your organization or you personally may pay, say, for Google. But most of these services you're not paying for. You're a content generator. You're generating their data. You are the product. to help pay for the service, they use your data. And as we're going through the shift in organizations and move from traditional on-premise applications to software as a service, to service-driven models, there's more of that shift to you being the product, or there's a shift where it's harder for you to get access, say, to the source code, or harder to get access to the data because it's now being offered to you as a service. You may be generating data as part of a government service, a business application, but it's being hidden behind layers and layers as a service. But the Libra aspects of open source are generating those cool, disruptive business models everyone raves about these days. None of these organizations can exist without open source. And yet, they offer their services as a service. They don't have to provide open APIs. They don't have to provide the code that runs those services. They could consume vast quantities of open source technologies. And unless they are under things like an Affero GPL license, they don't have to contribute back. There's no requirement on them. And many organizations, so many of you use these because it's popular, it's simple. Our accommodation this week is with Airbnb. It's awesome, it's great, it was simple to book, it was easy to consume. When we arrived in Hobart, we shared an Uber. Easy to consume, easy to book. Doesn't mean I don't want you to earn a crust. You know, we all like to, hopefully many of you here as professionals, your organization is paying for you to come here. They're making money out of this ecosystem we all live within. But my byline, my tagline is close the door behind you. Because if we start purely treating Libra as if it's gratis, if we don't feed the ecosystems that we live within and promote them, then they're at the risk of withering on the vine. In fact, one of our keynotes this week is about how do you help an open source project kind of die? How do you deal with the death of an open source project that you can no longer maintain? Are any of these logos that you don't recognize? Heartbeat, Heartbleed, Shellshock, Stage Fright, Keylock, Poodle. All of these were very, very serious vulnerabilities. All of which, or most of which, occurred because leading open source projects around which our day-to-day lives are built, our day-to-day projects are built, aren't being maintained adequately. There isn't the level of investment, they're not being looked after. You know. I got this quote off LWN a few weeks ago. I've actually linked back to the original blog post, and this is quite incredible to look at a previous security compromise in the context of today. So I've just highlighted, hopefully, a few words you can see. There was a zlib compromise back in 2002. If it occurred today, it would make Heartbleed look like a joke. Back then, it affected Windows and Linux. Today, it would affect every device on the planet. Every single device. That was a painful thing to resolve then. You imagine if a leading open source project that we rely on today, that's built into the Internet of Things devices within your household, had a similar level of compromise, a similar impact. Every router, every mobile phone, every television, your smart fridge, your car. The control system in my car runs Linux. If I can get it onto a Wi-Fi network, it has a default root username and password. If I change that, my car no longer has a warranty. You compromise my car. It's plugged into the engine management controller. It's plugged into almost every piece of the car. You could force my car to stop on the motorway. Thankfully, it's not permanently internet connected, but it could be. So today, how open are you? What are the things that you use? What do you consume as a service just to make your lives easier? Many of you use Slack regularly as part of your day job. GitHub is here as a sponsor. A large number of open source projects live on GitHub. And many of the communities we operate within are organized through technologies like Meetup. They're all things we consume as a service. They're all built around open source components and technologies. But how truly open are they? What do they share back to us? What are the alternatives? Things like Rocket Chat, GitLab. Someone can give me a free and open alternative to Meetup, I'd be really interested, but it just doesn't have the reach. It's hard. So how can we take the concepts of Libre and help drive a stronger open story into our organizations, into government, into our communities, into the businesses that we deal with? And this is where I want to work with you, because I'm seeing this. A statement we often have is there's an itch you want to scratch. You know, it's a problem that you're seeing all the time. I'm regularly dealing with organizations who purely want the gratis aspect of this. They can't give back. They don't understand how to give back. Or they're scared of being involved in those communities. So I see it as a three-step process. That's a kind of where I'm taking this today. Maybe I'm right, maybe I'm wrong. That's why I'm here with you. I want to hear what you are doing within the organizations, within the agencies you work with to help create this change we need to see. So first, acknowledge. Acknowledge that open is important, that you consume libraries, that you want to be open in your communication. In fact, if you drive a more open organization, you can drive higher levels of innovation. People are aware of how your organization's operating. Then you need to find a way to engage. It may just be one project. It may just be one community that you want to start engaging with it. And then how do you contribute? And a theme of the conference is about diversity. And we often talk about diversity in the context of gender or binary representation. I think something we get incredibly wrong in the community is to have a diverse community, it's not just about code. Code's at the bottom of my list here. All these other things are important. How many organizations are capable or willing to simply raise a bug report against the project that's important to them? I worked a few years ago, thankfully no longer, for an organization where we were informed we weren't allowed to raise bugs against open source projects because it might reveal intellectual property of the organization. The fact that we'd hit the bug may give our competitors an edge. The fact that internally we'd not only hit the bug, but we'd fix the bug, and we want to contribute the bug fix back upstream, was a sacking offense if you contributed it. This is ridiculous. Because that meant we had to maintain a fork of an open source project in order to do our jobs. Testing is incredibly important. Building test frameworks, understanding the importance of testing, and documentation is critical to all those projects we work with it. So your organization may have really great documenters. Why not have them spend a few hours contributing updates, fixes, enhancing the upstream documentation for the projects that matter to them. Designers, think back to those major security issues I had earlier. Nearly all of them had a website better branding, better content than the website of the project that had the security compromise. A well-designed open source project website, a well-designed logo, a good go-to-market, a good set of messaging. I haven't actually put marketing up there. There's possibly another aspect. You can help improve the ecosystem of a project that might otherwise be withering, struggling. Project management. Still amazes me, I deal with project managers in organizations today who don't feel they work in IT. They're project managers. Every project they've ever done has been in the area of IT, but they don't consider them part of IT, or don't even consider themselves part of an open source environment, even though they may project manage within open source projects, or projects that leverage large quantities of open source. How many of the projects you deal with today need strong project management, need some ownership, control to improve them, so they don't die, they don't wither? and then contribute some code. There's lots of other ways to be involved. And if I expand this further, open data. You know, with what you're doing, is it possible to make your data accessible through things like open APIs? Can you create interoperability through open APIs, open standards? So coming back, does open matter to you? Does open matter to the groups that you work with, the organizations, activism, things like GovHack? Open, we think, matters. Do we need to change? You know, ourselves. Something I've set for myself for the last couple of years has been, if I hit a bug, I raise a bugzilla. I make sure there is actually a bug report when I hit a bug. I don't live with the pain anymore of a workaround. I'll raise the bug. I'll then cross-link the bug into Launchpad, into Bugzilla, into the kernel bug tracking, into the free desktop Bugzilla, into other resources. Therefore, if one person fixes the bug, everyone gets the fix. And I'll make sure I continue to own the bug over its lifetime. So if someone's putting fixes out, I'll test them. I'll check them. I'm making sure things get closed off. Because for too long, I live with workarounds. I want those bugs to be fixed. One of my other bylines is fixing random pieces of hardware that should know better. Right? That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make other people's lives easier so they don't hit the bugs that are affecting me. And the last piece is, can we change others? Can we change other organizations? Can we change our communities and other groups around us? So this is where I really want to involve the room, is what resonates with you? What are you seeing? Because I've had this conversation in a community area where it became about data and APIs. I've had it in commercial organizations where it's been about outreach and how do they gain traction inside communities. So I want to see what your perspective is. What does open mean to you, and how can we help grow that engagement? So I want to engage the room now. Paul?
Cool, thanks. I guess one of the big worries that I have with this, you know, there are a small number of open source companies, and there are a reasonable number of companies that work with open source, that contribute back, and so forth. But it always, I find myself sometimes feeling like we are the small outliers in a vast marketplace of proprietary, closed source, closed mind systems, where the whole marketing aim is to lock you in and never let you escape. And I really worry, like, I think your point there about communication is good, because I feel sometimes can we actually reach ordinary people to make them care about this? Can we reach the decision makers when they are being constantly told by other organizations that open source doesn't matter, open doesn't matter, you need us because we are awesome and we do it better? Do you know what I mean? Mm.
So I deal with agencies within the New Zealand government regularly in my day job, and then I've had visibility of something happening within GovHack in New Zealand and through that Australia about the changing perception, say, in things like government and government agencies, realizing that they've got all this data and information that maybe we could share with the populace. And so you start to see some of those mind shifts. A critical thing is within large commercial organizations is many of them have larger open source engineering teams than even a company like Red Hat. I mean, Samsung has more Linux engineers than Red Hat does. That's not uncommon now. And what I've seen recently is, particularly with things like the OpenStack project, is that companies are beginning to realize that the big projects that really matter to them. They need to get involved with upstream. So you have things like all the big US telcos might be consuming OpenStack from Red Hat or from Arantis or from Ubuntu or from one of the HP or one of the other big players, but they are still involved in the upstream community to create the change, to be involved, to affect the roadmap, because they are critical to their business going forward. So some of this is changing, but is it enough? And I'm also, though, still seeing organizations, often in a consulting or services space, who will consume open source, particularly all the libraries, all the development capability available today when you're developing mobile apps and web apps and services for end customers, but don't contribute back. They don't have a policy around how to contribute back into the community. That's, I think, a real pain point. You've got people there who are very development focused. They're consuming vastly, contributing back very little.
So thanks. There, you raised a couple of good points of what people can do to contribute, right? And one of the points you made was actually very much highlighted one of the problems with that. When you talked about the bugs, you talked about how you ended up cross-linking it to, you know, bazillion bugzillers. And if you're, you know, a naive company or someone who is not like working for SUSE or Red Hat or someone else who is being paid to do open source development, that's a really huge barrier to entry, right? You end up reporting your bug, and then the Debian developer goes like, or SUSE, whatever, developer goes like, this is an upstream bug, report it there. And you're like, when do I have time for that, right? Mm. So there, and have you ever tried to see a user interface designer engage with developers and trying to tell them that, and they go like, no, this is fine. I like this look, right? And it's, so I hear your point, and getting more people involved is really important, but it's not just something that they must do. We must be easier to engage with. I think that's my point.
I mean, take this and say, well, maybe with the people you're dealing with or the organizations you're dealing with, this isn't the right order. Maybe their best entry point is documentation fixes. Maybe their best entry point is they've got spare testing time. What is the best way for them to start to engage? For me, one of the easiest things is, and it's been highlighted at LCA in the past and other conferences like OSDC, many years ago watching Stuart Smith trying to present, and his entire presentation time was taken by OpenOffice trying to open his presentation. And it got to the point with so many of us that we wouldn't even bother opening bugs anymore, because we were just living with the pain. We weren't trying to resolve the pain. It became a scratch I wanted to itch rather than an itch I wanted to scratch. It was just a persistent problem, and I could live with it. Yes, I know enough to be able to link these things. Sometimes all it takes is a quick search. You find the bug, you attach yourself to the bug now has another person with the same problem. That may be a tipping point. It may be that your bug report has that extra piece of data that's missing to help resolve it. It's hard, but we need to do something.
So I'd just like to expand on a point that this gentleman over here made earlier, which was essentially how do we communicate outward, though. I think the part of the problem is, I suppose, here we're preaching to the choir. We're all here at LinuxConf with that rough idea. So when a technical audience wants to talk to a non-technical audience, how do we like present the case, essentially? I mean, that, I guess in some ways it's sort of how... It's like a call to arms for advocacy in a sense, but there still actually needs to be a process, or, you know, what do we say, essentially?
And that's one reason for the session. How are you engaging if you're doing this? How do you sell things like GovHack to an organization, or open data or open source to an organization when you're not going in through the technical window? That's why I asked you to come forward.
You want to go first? Sorry, are you going first? So there's lightning talks this afternoon. I might propose, I'm going to do a lightning talk about how to convince others. Because I do this every day in government, in population, in everywhere. And there are ways to do it. But the other thing to recognize is that it's not just about us trying to convince other people about what we think's good for them. A lot of people are coming to this way of thinking because they are getting their asses kicked with alternative models. So a lot of people are starting to pick this stuff up because they're actually realizing the benefits themselves about it. So there's a lot happening. So I might try to sneak in a lightning talk.
Yay.
Hi, I work with libraries and librarians and they live and breathe open source. But the problem is it's too hard for them. They don't know how to jump into GitHub because it's way too hard to deal with. They just want to report it to a really simple interface. So how can we change the mindsets of developers and designers to say, hey, why don't we make it a little bit more user-friendly so we can get the community involved?
Hmm. And some of that may come down to things like auto bug reporting capabilities built into. It's a thing that we face within our commercial customer base. We're trying to make that easier. It's the things that all the distros face. You know, you have a bug crash on an Ubuntu system and it will try and automatically file a bug report. Likewise, you've got a Fedora system set up correctly, it will try and do the same. Trying to make some of that interface simpler just to give us more data to be able to crunch and solve the problem. But it's when the problem isn't a distro thing, when it's something else, how do you know where to report it? And often, you're a step away because the software you're consuming is coming indirectly through a distribution or through a vendor. It's not all the way back. And that causes conflicts because you're not running the latest version, you're running the distribution's version. Yes, it's not easy.
The thing that I found, and thinking of from the second guy asking, is the one thing that I think we all need to do is actually just give that bit more time. You know, actually go and file the bug. Actually go and make the patch. Actually write a blog post about it. You know, actually sit down and link those bugs, you know, together. Yes, it's, you know, sometimes it feels like you've spent hours on hassling over this. Why go to the extra trouble? But that is what, you know, one of the big things that I think contributes so much to open source and free software being useful is the immense amount of information out there about, from people like us, saying, hey, I had this weird, you know, problem with MythTV 021 and I fixed it with this, or, you know, I managed to, you know, I built my MythTV system with these components and someone else will find that useful.
Well, don't we have the risk though that the amount of information is almost too diverse? That the solution to your problem isn't in the obvious place. How many of you fixed an Ubuntu problem out of the Arch forums because they're really active, or vice versa? Things don't quite seem to mesh. Now, they may work for us. Can you get Stephen up next? He's been waving his hand.
Yeah, sorry.
So is that a problem we in the community need to try and fix, bring these things back a bit more cohesively? So it's a lot simpler to find a pathway to the solution.
So just to be the curmudgeon in the room, I think it's because most of this audience here and in a lot of the open source projects, and we have this debate inside of Red Hat all the time, believes that free, as in Libra, is a value unto itself for most of the world. While I think most of the world could give 2 cents about free or Libra. They don't care. What they want is a slide program that shows their slides. They don't care about open standards for data, like some big GBIF complicated format. They want to know when they look up their parcel that they can find what's the price, what's the tax value of my parcel. And I think the thing that we as a community get too caught up into is this Libra is a value in and of itself. And it is for us, it is for me. That's why I'm here, it's why I use open source software. But for the majority of the people in the world, if I try to sell my mom, hey, this phone, it's running open source software. It crashes 6 times and you have to go to this forum to figure out how to load this driver so that you can put on Facebook to see the pictures of your grandkids. We've lost the, so in all of this stuff, I think the real thing to get people to acknowledge, engage, and contribute is to make it actually usable for the things that people want to use it for, and then people actually care about what you've built.
So I've sold open data and free and open source software as a concept to a lot of large organizations and then a lot of individuals. With large organizations, I don't talk about free or open at all. I say you can modify it. But I don't mean go to Bugzilla and file a ticket. I don't mean, you know, download the code. I mean fund developers to do it or things like that, typically. With individuals, I'm most successful when people talk about how they try to pirate software. I say, oh, use this, it doesn't have any viruses. I was at a barbecue on Saturday, and the person I was talking to said, oh, I've been trying to pirate MapInfo, GIS software, if anyone's aware. I knew you would know. It turned out she had QGIS on her computer. She just didn't realize it did the same stuff as MapInfo, so in 10 minutes, she became a QGIS user. But it wasn't a focus on that it was free or open. She wasn't going to pirate it and get viruses.
Well, this comes back to the kind of consulting and services organizations. It's easy for them to build a service for a customer around a whole chunk of open source technologies. They're immediately accessible. They're the type of organizations I really want to see change within to get them to contribute back. You know, they're a great opportunity. Likewise, within government, we need government to realize the importance of open source, open standards, open data. So some of it's about that bigger picture conversation. I agree with Steve. There's the pain points that are hard to fix. We need to make this easier. We need to make things just work. But to make some of that stuff just work, we need to get bigger organizations to realize it's important for them to contribute. Government departments and so forth. That's my take.
Cool. Thanks for your talk, by the way. I'm Nick. I am one of those consultancy types. I'll just make 2 points, one of which is this experience for closed source software is equally, if not more, terrible. If you go back to a lot of closed source companies and say, hey, I found a really bad bug, a terrible runaway in one of your products, they come back to you and say, who's your sales rep? And you go, oh, well, don't really have one. I'm a consultant. And they go, well, we can't talk to you then. So it's not like we're the only ones. The other thing I just wanted to mention, you actually raised this point yourself. If you're trying to convince a bigger organization to contribute back upstream, there's a really strong financial argument, which is you won't have to keep maintaining a parallel infrastructure. And I think that's something you really need to push in these big orgs. You need to say, yes, you should upstream it for your own financial good. If you don't, you're stuck for the rest of the life of the use of this thing, maintaining your own fork and trying to merge stuff across. If you upstream it, you've only got that pain briefly until your patch gets around back into the upstream.
So sometimes it's about reading what the pain point is in that organization or what the trigger is. How can we help them make the change? It may be financial,
yeah,
right? It may be they want to hire the best staff. And one way of doing that, many organizations flash their open source credentials as a way of getting the best people to work for them.
Facebook does that. That's their explicit reason for not open source.
Yeah. So what is the trigger? What are the other triggers you see? They're the two big ones I see. What are the other triggers to get inside those and make the change? So Kathy and...
One of you first.
Oh.
I think to me, open is kind of synonymous with transparency. And if clients cannot see easily what their software is doing to them or for them, then they don't tend to think about it, as someone else said, they just want the end result. But knowing what's going on as well, I believe they should be made aware of. And that's when they can start to care, because I don't think enough people do care because about that sort of thing. As I say, they just care about the end result and not what else is going on. So it's an element of trust, transparency. That's what openness is from my perspective. And I think when you can get the average Joe on the street to start thinking and caring about what's happening to their stuff, then hopefully that will engage them in conversations with their mates as well. And then that will raise an awareness and improve the consciousness of the importance of openness and transparency.
So, picking up on the Libra as a value in its own right, and extending that, we also see choice as a value in its own right as developers, and every now and then someone will say, why can't we have just one package manager? And as developers, there are good arguments for that choice, but when it comes to users, and particularly, again, librarians or whoever wanting to submit bug reports, then if you have chosen not to have a support at email address or a support dot website, then you have chosen, in a sense, not to engage with your users. So consistency in allowing users to report those issues and to engage is also important in that interface, I think.
Thanks. So I spent most of my time trying to engage large enterprises in deploying and using open source, right? So that's part of my job. And I found that at the end of the day, for that class of consumer, it always boils down to a financial argument. You have to figure out how to translate to that. So hiring people, that's a problem all successful IT companies face very much. And clearly their open source helps because it allows you to recruit faster, which they translate to it lowers their cost of training, right? Even transparency matters. We have some customers who have legal obligations to be able to inspect and modify their code, and that's something that, yeah, there is this concept of shared source, but you know they can't reproduce a build because they're not getting that bit, so that's a big advantage for them. And there's one argument that often sways people because it's actually not in our interest to point out. And that is that when we tell them about the fact that, yeah, you know, if you're ever unhappy with the support you're getting from us, you can get it from someone else. We would really love you not to, but you can. And this avoiding of vendor lock-in is something that's really important. And frankly speaking, it's the area where large companies like, you know, I work for SUSE and you work for Red Hat, where we occasionally shoot ourselves in the foot because we are very much interested in having a captive customer as well. I mean, a successful long-term customer, right? Even the open source world is trying to discourage customers from exercising their freedoms because we want their money. And that's a fine line to walk to, because a lot of this information, documentation, if I want to look up a certain bug, I don't have access to the Red Hat Enterprise Bugzilla, you don't have access to the SUSE Linux Enterprise Bugzilla, and even in another open source world, we are locking each other out from some of those information bases. And I know there are strong financial reasons for doing that, but so do they exist for the customer who chooses not to contribute to open source?
It is hard, and you do have that double-edged sword, but the fact is, we don't exist without the community, and you know, we as Red Hat don't exist without SUSE, without Canonical and Ubuntu, without the work Oracle does within the community as well. All of that makes the ecosystem stronger. And one way for an even stronger ecosystem, and I'm starting to see it now, is where our customers are strong contributors back into the projects that are important to them. That makes the ecosystem stronger, makes it more valid. Ultimately, yes, the customer could move away. They could go back to community. They could look after themselves. But it's going to make the community better and stronger. And for me, that's a strong outcome. And it's a strong outcome Red Hat strongly supports.
Cheers, Steve. Good presentation. I'd like to pick up on a couple of points that you opened your presentation with, where you booked your Uber, and it was easy, and it was frictionless. And you booked your Airbnb, and it was easy, and it was frictionless. And then you tried to submit a bug report and got it sucked, right? So if we take that experience, that user experience from Uber and Airbnb, how do we UX the free and open and Libre ecosystems? What is the UX layer that makes people come to open by default? Not because they see the value in openness and transparency that we do, because that's, you know, otherwise they'd be on this side of the fence and not that side of the fence. How do we UX the ecosystem?
Hmm. I know there's one project that Red Hat's heavily involved with, Patternfly, that's all about changing the way UI can be developed and enhanced. There are important advances going on there, and you're quite right, that's critical. And how do most of you consume your data today? It's not on a laptop. It's on a tablet, it's on a mobile phone. How often do we still hit a website or a service that still doesn't work well with the way we predominantly consume our data today?
One little concern I have with bug reports is we're not short of bug reports. We're short of fixes to them. The other thing that sort of comes to mind for me is we've got, I've lost my train of thought, just give it to someone else.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm Jason from Red Hat. I just want to share a little story about making things easy and open data. So I'm kind of the caretaker of the Victims Project, which is a security reporting framework. And my predecessors set up this project, and they built an API, and it's got a database behind it. It's very easy to submit bug reports that way. But people actually choose to use our open data that's just hosted in GitHub, I think maybe because they're consuming it straight from GitHub. So I think those choices in setting up projects, since we're probably a lot of software developers and that, really matter, because if you set it up so it's your data is also open as well as your APIs and things, then we found that heaps more people actually contribute to the data directly on GitHub, even though the UI sucks. They have to do a pull request.
The UI on GitHub is way easier, though, than Bugzilla. Even inside Red Hat, I love that we have open source projects that are hosted in GitHub. Because, easy to sign in. I don't have to do remember that weird authentication. And I just do, I've already signed in, pull request, or issue report. And it's so easy and simple.
The one thing I've noticed is when people talk about how do we get organizations to use open source, it seems like the basis of the argument that I've been hearing is long-term thinking. And so that's always a difficult sell from everything I've ever seen. But long-term thinking, I think, is essentially what we need to promote in that area.
Well, acknowledge many organizations are using open source without realizing it. They're consuming open source libraries in their development projects and don't even realize the licenses they're agreeing to every time they release their product. Yeah.
There is I do work for a prominent North American software vendor and hardware. But anecdotally, aside from corporate work, I identify myself not as a developer, but I have contributed. And what I found recently as a non-developer trying to contribute is that projects have ramp in speeds. We find startups and the flavor of the month projects, which are almost anathema to distributions. As Red Hat and SUSE and Oracle, we want projects that have long-term maintainability because we have customers that don't upgrade. You know, I work customers on versions of software that are 10, 15 years old because that works for them and, you know, too difficult to upgrade. And yet we have, you know, these new flavors of the month projects, who shall remain nameless, that can no longer run on our currently stable versions of distros because they need stuff that's in a kernel that only got released last week. And when you're pushing to projects like that, you know, this almost anti-distribution mindset from the project that we don't care if your GCC is too old, you have to upgrade. We don't care that all of these enterprise customers, you're not going to get any of them because you've upgraded, you've gone too far ahead of the enterprise platform. Stop making it difficult to get enterprise customers. You want them to go into open source, but they need, you know, a CEO needs platform stability. He needs to know he's got 3, 5, 7 years of support on his enterprise distributions, he can't run products that require him to upgrade every 2 weeks because they've just added a new thing and then the whole thing stops. You know, so we stop making our customers' lives difficult.
Did you see the thread on the chat list? I'm trying to remember the piece of software. Back there, Daniel with the hat. Okay, all right, 5 minutes. So there was something on the chat list. There was a piece of software being discussed, and someone said the only way you're going to run this piece of software is to go and pull, was it Rust, from GitHub, pull the very, very latest commit, and then it might work. Anything older, forget about it. It's like, that really makes my life easier, you know, if I want to consume that open source project. And yes, things are changing. Containerization is changing the way we can consume a lot of open source projects in a kind of self-contained manner.
And there was, you know, and again, non-professionally recently, well, quasi-professionally, I've been, you know, engaging with projects to try and get Oracle Linux support into them, you know, across a bunch of things because I'm glutton for punishment, clearly. But, you know, I never programmed in Go before, and I had a particular experience, and I'll shout out to the Core OS team that do Clair, which is a great security scanner for Docker containers. You should run it. But I opened, you know, somebody logged, one of my customers logged an issue on GitHub saying Clair doesn't have Oracle Linux support. And then pinged me, because I'm the product manager, and going, hey, could you look at this? And I went to them and I said, look, I don't know anything about Go, but I'll give it a go. And the mentoring that the Clair team did for me as a non-Go developer, to say, okay, that's 90% good, it's 5% pretty great, and then it's 5% woefully awful. Let's work on that 5% to get it to good, and then merge it in. And it was, again, glutton for punishment, doing this between the Christmas and New Year break, working on Go while trying to avoid hangovers. And they just went to each time iterating, I was committing, and they were looking and committing and looking and going, let's tweak. And then we had to pull a whole bunch of stuff out that they had just merged because it broke everything for a whole bunch of distros. And it was this learning experience with them that they were just really patient with. This is brilliant. This was an experience that I haven't had in a long time with another vendor's product. You know, being upfront about, hey, I'm from Oracle, I want the support. They were, A, fully supportive about getting another distro in there, saying, yes, we absolutely want to scan you, and be very supportive of a non-Go developer. Let's ramp up your Go skills. Why don't you cut and paste this section from this section? That'll be what you want. That was a really nice experience.
If anyone wants an example of this, watch Emily Dunham's talk on the Rust community from last year's LCA. It was outstanding talk, and it gave an example of how a community should operate, should engage, should mentor. And that's one reason why it's becoming so successful.
Taking what you just mentioned, it makes me think that almost sounds like a business strategy. Make your code move so fast, it's technically open, but no one else can use it.
Right, I think we need to wrap it up. Thank you so much for your contributions. Hopefully, you have something to think about. I'm here all week. So please come and tell me the things I got wrong. Please tell me other ways of helping people change. This isn't just about my day job. I've been in the community for the best part of the last 20 years, and I need to see that community grow and survive. Open source has no future. Thanks.
Thank you, Steve.